today. Thank you for your attendance here at John Janzen's celebration of life service today. We are indeed grateful for John's life and for how he lived and the way that he lived and the impact that he made on our church, on this campus, and to his family and friends and around the world. We are incredibly grateful for Papa John's life here today. We're in a sense in a living room, so we're kind of quaint and just a wonderful celebration of who John was. We realize he lived an amazing life from start to finish. All of the details of his life, many of them are recorded here in this handout in your program, and I would encourage you to read through that because it is truly remarkable how he lived and what God did in his life. He was just short of 91 years of life. And that dash between June 18th, 1933 and June 10th, 2024 really marks an amazing, remarkable, God-blessed life. He was filled with passion, with pursuit of God, with the power of God's Holy Spirit indwelling in him. He had a prominence about him that was wonderful, a presence that exuded the love of God. He was indeed a man after God's own heart, and in many ways was certainly a gem. Papa John was a jack of all trades, in a sense. Everything that he touched, pretty much he fixed. And even more than that, he was more than a jack of all trades. He was a master of many trades in the way that he lived. He loved God. He loved his family. He loved his wife, Louise. He loved his church. He loved this place at Grace Community Church, served so beautifully and faithfully over the years. Always looking on the bright side of life, he had a warm and welcoming persona about him. Papa John was a truth speaker. He was direct, an unforgettable conversationalist, and had the most remarkable smile that we will always hold dear in our hearts. He was warm, welcoming, resourceful, godly, God-fearing. He was organized in many ways, orderly, scheduled, and he was obedient to our Savior and Lord. He loved to travel. Mission trips were prominent. I think we counted up over 20 countries that Papa John had served in. Many of those opportunities involved his fix-it ability, incredibly gifted in making things work, plumbing, in so many different avenues of his ministry that was so beautifully appreciated. He was here at Grace Community for over, I think, 20 plus years and made coffee for years, drove the tram for years, welcomed people as they came onto this campus, loved by his Sunday school classes, by XYZ, by Summit, service to people, programs, church, and was just a remarkable man. In the book of Psalms 139, I love this passage of scripture. The entire chapter, it just speaks and exudes of God's omniscience, his omnipresence. And I love these verses right in the middle of the chapter that says, "All the days ordained for me were written in your book before one of them came to be." Psalm 116, verse 15 says, "Precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his saints." And in the Living Bible, it says it beautifully, "His loved ones are very precious to him, and he does not lightly let them die." And in Psalm 115, 13, he says, "He will bless those who fear the Lord, small and great alike." Psalm 73, 26, "My flesh and my heart may fail, but God is the strength of my heart and my portion forever." And then Isaiah 57, 1 and 2, The righteous perish, and no one ponders it in his heart. Devout men are taken away, and no one understands that the righteous are taken away to be spared from evil. Those who walk uprightly enter into peace. They find rest as they lie in death. I love how the writer indicates they will lie in rest as they lie in death. My wife and Abby Andrick, long-term members of Grace Community Church here, had the privilege to go and visit Papa John the day before he entered heaven. And as he was laying in his room in Mesa, as we entered the room, that smile that Papa John was known for just came across his face. His countenance changed, and he brightened up so beautifully. He was not real communicative, but you could easily see that he was tracking with everything that we said, everything that we had talked about. We reminisced on his life and ministry and how he kept the lodge up and running with his fix-it ability, how he represented the Lord beautifully on his mission trips. We read Psalm 23 that Karen will be reading here in just a few minutes. We shared Proverbs 3, 5, and 6, and the entire time, Papa John's eyes were glued to each one who spoke, and his smile was just so beautiful. As we closed in prayer, we realized this was probably the last time we would see him on this side of heaven. We'll see him again when we all rejoice and we join our Heavenly Father in heaven as well, which is where we believe Papa John is right now. I'd like to ask that we open in prayer and ask God to bless our time as we celebrate his life from different family and friends who will be sharing beautiful songs, an amazing slideshow, and as we hear how God worked in this incredible man's life, let's pause and give thanks to the Lord as we begin today. Father God, we're reminded again that you are sovereign, that you are God and God alone. You're the author, the perfecter of life. You give life and you take life. We understand, God, that you're in control. And so, Lord, today we say, God, thank you for the nearly 91 years of life that we had the privilege of connecting with John in such a beautiful way. God, thank you for who John was and who he is, who he will continue to remain as we hold him close in our hearts. And as we reflect on the impact he had in our lives, we pause this morning to say, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, God, for John's life. And so we honor him today as we honor you in the process. It's in the precious name of Jesus we pray. Amen. Beautiful song, I Can Only Imagine, sung by your precious sister, Catherine. God bless you, Kim.
Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence until my knees? Will I fall? Will I sing
John that Nurse Louise took care of him for a long time in the hospital, and that was the beginning of their sweet relationship. So for myself, my name is Karen Frenchamone, and about 11 years ago I was hired here at the church for the job of guest services. Papa John and Louise were a huge active part of the sweetness of my time in serving Grace here, because their hearts were that to give and serve. And so behind the scenes, most people didn't know that every single Sunday for many years, now I'm talking a couple, for many years, we were tucked back in the kitchen, that's by the Connection Center over there, and he would probably make somewhere from 14 to 25 gallons of coffee per Sunday. And to be able to do that, they would arrive here at 6:30 a.m. and would be little Trojans in the kitchen. And most of you know that Papa John was a plumber and that had that gifting of being able to fix things. Well, two things I can say: if the coffee machine did not perform for him, He was able to kick it or do something really special to make it work, to be able to serve our whole church. We're talking the whole church he made home for. And just in speaking about some of his jobs here at church, he was also a tram driver. So he would meet visitors and the first people to our church there for many years. And then Chris Allen, that will be up here in a few minutes, also was a part of that ministry with John. The other thing that I think is slightly funny before I get a little more serious is that you won't go to a potty today that Papa John did not either install or repair. Mm-hmm. And that's my understanding, there's probably around 20 restrooms here on campus. And so he did a whole lot of that installation. So I can't not go be in the restroom and think about how Papa John was probably in here many times. I love Papa John, and we did serve a lot of time together, but I met him in a time frame that I was very vulnerable in life, just post-divorce, when I had gotten the job here. And he and Louise did such a beautiful job of taking care of me, inviting me to things, to their home, and just including me. And so in that stage of love, they were such beaming lights for Jesus. So it was just a true honor for me to get to know that, have that opportunity to get to serve alongside the both of them. I love them both. So today I have Papa John's Bible and his favorite scripture, I'm understanding, or chapter in the Bible is Psalms 23. So I'm going to read that, and I would say now most of you know the scripture. Look at it with fresh eyes today and look at it from that point of view of this being Papa John's favorite. Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters, and he restores my soul. He guides me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. And even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For you are with me, your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. You anoint my head with oil, and my cup overflows. Surely goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
Amen.
Thank you.
We're going to have a slideshow.
keep that focused on that. I'm going to turn these lights off.
Good morning, everyone. Look, now there is, I'm supposed to put it back in the stand. I'm partially Italian, I think. I have a habit of talking with my hands. I told you not to do that or I might toss the thing. I was doing okay sitting in the seat, and I had to get up here to talk about my friend. Friend's an interesting word. It's kind of changed over the years. We have a lot of friends, but social media seems to have taken it to a whole new meaning. We have friends and unfriend them. Have likes and followers and things like that. I am very blessed, and I think each of us here in this room feel the same way. John Janzen considered me, us, his friend. Friends is not a one-way trip. It's a passage between two people. As I look back, and I remember, and many of you know the story of how this first came about. My brother-in-law needed some help here at church for someone to drive a tram. And he said, I really need you to help in the summertime. The volunteers are down. And I got you paired up with this guy. He's just like you. You're going to like him. So I wanted to make a good impression first time on a tram. So I'd get here a little bit early and jump on a tram and drive out to the first tram stop. About 5 minutes later, I see this guy rolling up. You know, you make those real quick first impressions. Top button on his shirt wasn't buttoned. Gnawing on a toothpick. Now this is church. This is 1990s. People were in suits and ties still and everything else. I look at this old boy, and he's about 15 years older than me. I go, man, we're going to hit it off fine. So I gets out of my tram and I walk over. Hi, my name is, and before I can get another word out of my mouth, this guy looks at me and says, you're in my tram. And I go, what? He says, you're in my tram. That's the tram I like. And I've been driving trams, and you're the new guy, and that's my tram. Okay. My name's Chris. You must be Josh. And that's how it started. Over the course of the years, like many of you, I got to support John on mission trips. I never got a chance to go on a mission trip with him, but I got to support him on mission trips. And one of the things he loved and was seen in some of the slides that, you know, we had before you was the fact that no matter what country he went to, the kids all came around him. They didn't know English in many, many cases, but they could say the word Papa John. And they instantly adopted him as Papa John. Papa John worldwide. And he would come back and he would be sharing those stories with all of us about all the different trips and the things that he did. He was a very, he's a man's man. You talk about his smile and everything else. But you can't help but look at those pictures and realize, and it's an overused phrase of somebody being larger than life. John was one of those rare individuals. He loved to share stories. He loved to share experiences. And heaven knows he loved to mentor people. He loved to teach people. That was the one thing he wanted to do and where our friendship grew. Karen was talking about the Johns in this church. And trust me, that's what we call them. Do you wonder where they got the name Johns? All right. Right outside the door here is one of the projects we got to work on together. That used to be, way back in the day, that used to be the changing room. This is where they used to do a lot of the weddings. And that was where the brides did their changing. It was a changing room. It was really a glorified closet. And we had to go in there. John had to tear up the floors, set in the new pipes and everything else. We've got pictures of when we were working on that project. And the interesting thing at the time was, right next to it, the church has been remodeled a couple times since then, but that was the prayer room. And John was adamant. My job was to do the drywall after we did the plumbing. John was adamant that we stuffed the walls with extra insulation between the bathroom and the prayer room so that no one would hear anything that was going on in the bathroom while they were in the prayer room. That's one of your true stories. I could stand up here, folks. How do you condense a friendship of nearly 30 years into 5 or 10 minutes? And we all feel the same way. The only thing I have to close. My brain is having a collision of different thoughts, as I'm sure each of us is. You're thinking of different things. A pastor that we both like, that used to preach here, Pastor Darrell Delahousse, recently talked, and perhaps we can all take this one with us today. We're all in a room, And in that room is a thermometer and a thermostat. Thermometer reflects the temperature of the room, and you become part of that room. Or you can become a thermostat, and you can set the temperature for that room. John with his thermostat, he set the temperature of the room wherever he went. Thank you.
I've known John longer than anybody. He was less than 4 years older than I was. And when he was 16 years old, my grandmother passed away. And he adopted my mother as his surrogate mother. So he was at our home a lot. As he was growing up, he was rather wayward, quite a bit. And as a family, we prayed for his salvation. And he had a great sense of humor, and often he would be quite funny. One dinner, my Aunt Annie had invited her new boyfriend over for dinner, and she made lovely soft rolls. While the basket of rolls was passed around, Johnny pipes up and says, "When I say take your pick, I mean it quite literally." At the time I accepted the Lord, I was just four, and at breakfast the next morning, I announced to everybody that I had become a Christian. And later that morning, I was playing outside. Johnny comes up to me and he says, "Now that you accept Jesus, you can't do anything bad anymore." And John, he could be really hilarious at times. One time, Grandpa was having evening devotions and was reading about lost sheep during and since Grandpa didn't raise sheep, he just raised cattle, Johnny went and struggled carrying the baby, the newest born calf. And he said, "Well, this is the lost sheep." And I could tell you many stories growing up together because I spent a lot of time with my grandparents. And got to know Johnny as a young boy a lot. Thank
you. Hi, I'm Shirley Keller. Uncle Johnny was an uncle through marriage. And Chris, when you told me about your first meeting with John, I'll tell you about my first meeting with him. It was in 1967, and I just married Dolores's youngest brother. And we lived in Abbotsford. And so I was writing all my thank you notes, and I had written "Dear John and Enid," and the next day I get a phone call, and we were living with my husband's parents at that time, and he said, "Okay, you know, you wrote John and Enid, but really it is, don't forget, it is Uncle Johnny and Enid, so from then on I would never call him anything other than Uncle Johnny, because that's who he was, right? You can understand that. I have wonderful memories of John and Uncle Johnny and Louise, and we were, my first husband and him were, you know, uncle and nephew, and Uncle Johnny was Ron's favorite uncle, one of his favorite. He had many uncles, but Uncle Johnny kind of stood out because he was a little renegade kind of a personality, and I think as a young kid, Ron really enjoyed that about him. But then there were, and I heard stories all the time about this Johnny, and I'd only met him a couple of times, and but the stories were just hilarious, like the ones Dolores was saying, and I mean, there was just so many of them. And then time went on, and I met Louise, and she was such a lovely lady that when we came down here to Arizona, Louise and I just connected. So we were just like sisters, and we get together all the time, and I miss her terribly, and I know that John missed her too. So I'm going to just read a poem, and I'll pass this on to Fred. It's called A Measure of a Man. Not how did he die, but how did he live? Not what did he gain, but what did he give? These are the units that measure the worth of a man as a man, regardless of birth. Not what is his station, but had he a heart, and how did he play his God-given part? Was he seen, was he ever ready with a word of good cheer to bring back a smile or banish a tear? Not what was his church, nor what was his creed, but did he benefit those really in need? Not what did the sketch in the newspaper say, but how many were sad when he passed away?
Thank you. I'm Fred Jury's husband, and my recollections of Uncle Johnny, because he did insist that I call him that as well. So I go back only to 2011 when Shirley and I were doing our Route 66 drive all the way from Chicago to California. And we were driving down Route 40, and Shirley says, well, I had heard about real estate, or there being some big real estate correction or something happening. And so when we were driving through, I said, you know, we should check into Phoenix, even though to me Phoenix was a swear word at that point, because I'd never been to Arizona. But Turkey said, well, I have an uncle, Uncle Johnny, that happens to live in Mesa, and he's also in real estate. And so she contacted him, and sure enough, Johnny and Louise invited us down. And that was the start of, they became our Arizona connection, our Arizona parents, and started 12 or 13 years now, and every Christmas we had to delay Christmas or had to celebrate early or whatever, depending on schedules, because Christmas didn't happen unless we were all together here in Arizona, kind of thing. But yeah, being a kind of a fellow fix-it guy, Johnny and I could spend long evenings trading horror stories and stories of amazing successes. And John had a million of them, and really, really learned to enjoy them, and discover that he was a man who did what he said he was going to do, and that was a wonderful. He was a wonderful friend to have here. Was always there. They were always there for us. Anyway, I know what Chris means about you start talking, you start hearing people's stories, and all these ideas start colliding. So I'm just going to abandon my notes and hand the mic over to whoever is going next.
Thank you.
Matthew.
Good morning. Thank you all for attending or watching on the live streaming internet feed. My name is Matthew Janzen. I'm the proud son of John and Louise Janzen. My partner, Trina, and I flew down here yesterday from Shawnee Lake, BC, Canada. Just happy to be here with you all. So Rob asked me if I'd stand up and tell a short story. And one of my favorite stories is it's titled Elvis Impersonator in Las Vegas for John's 50th birthday. So Mom calls me and says, Dad and I are meeting in Vegas, which we meet in Vegas quite a bit because coming from Victoria, they'd come down from Mesa. It was a good little spot to meet, and I'd have conferences down there a lot, so I'd stay a couple extra days and spend time with the folks. So Mom calls me and says, it's going to be Dad's 50th birthday. Do you want to come? And I was like, oh, this would be fantastic. I said, I think I'm going to dress up like Elvis and punk Dad. I was like, what? So I went through all my costume stuff for Halloween, and I have this really crazy kind of purple shiny shirt with this low cut collar that was leopard print. I found some old gold chains I had and some crazy big glasses. And I thought, well, what can I do for a sideburns? So I bought some mascara so I could crawl it all the way find my face. So I fly down to Vegas. Make my plan that night, and my parents are really early risers. I'm not. So I get up in the morning and I do my scouting trip. And I know they'd like to start off by the pool first. So I go to the pool area and I see them and they're lounging on the sunbeds and just chilling out. So, okay. So I run back to my room and I put on my shirt, put on my big gold medallions and my glasses, and I spend about half an hour putting in the chops and stuff. And so, okay, better go get them. So I zip out to the pool. Along the way, I actually find some pamphlets of Elvis impersonators in Vegas. So I was like, oh, we'll grab some of these. This is good for making the point a bit more real. So as I'm walking to the pool, people are stalking me. He's like, hey, when's your show? And I'm like, I have to stop. Well, Friday, I guess, yeah. At 10, so please come. So I'm marketing for this Elvis guy. So I get to the pool, and yeah, they're not there. So now I know it's breakfast time. Well, I think the place they stay is called Palace Station. I think it has 6 restaurants. So I sit back and go, okay. And I look at where they all are, where I am. So I pick the furthest one closest. I walk up, look around, no. Next restaurant, next restaurant, next restaurant. In the meantime, I'm being stopped and I'm still marketing this guy's advertising for new friends of the Elvis show that night. So I get to the last restaurant. And Mom and Dad are just leaving. I was like, ah, I got them. And so they're leaving their table, they're walking up, and I'm pulling on my suit, smiling, and I got my pamphlets, and walk right up to my dad, and I go, you gotta come see my show tonight. And if you know Dad, you get in his face, he's like, he'll go ninja on you. So he's like, in his face, I'm like, whoa. He goes, what are you doing? Why are you dressed like this? He was completely happy to see me, but so confused. He looks at Mom, and Mom's like giggling because she's, you know, orchestrated part of this with me. And so we sit down and have breakfast. And my dad's just staring at me. He's like, I don't get it. Well, son, are you working down here? Like, do you need money? I'm like, no, Dad, it's your 15th birthday. Surprise, that's why I'm here. And he's like, he was so baffled. So we finished our breakfast, I went and changed, and we hung out the entire weekend and just did lovely little events in Vegas that we always do. And I just always catch up looking over going, because in his mind, I'm in Canada, and now I'm in his zone. And why is he here? And he looked at Mom and goes, it's my birthday. Does he need a job? So I think if you're gonna meet my when you see my dad again in heaven and talk to him about the story, he'll be like, yeah, I think my son needs some money. He's down there. I know he does. That's one of my favorite stories. I have actually many stories in that. So for me, my dad, he was a very strong man, strong work ethics. He had a great son. Very strong family man. I had one time when I was calling my parents, I had to deal with this AT&T operator, and this lady kept on saying, you're just just so polite. I'm like, well, it's my parents. It's the upbringing they gave me. I'm just, that's the way I am right now. So a lot of my traits correctly come from my dad. And I recognize that. He was an entrepreneur. He did many different things. And I look back at the correlation of some of the things that I've done after what he's done. And it's just uncanny, some of the things we've all done together. So I always want to cherish the lessons that that dad imparted and the values that he instilled in me, and all the memories we shared. So rest in peace, Dad. Knowing that your spirit lives within me, God bless. Thank you.
We started a recovery home. We help women who have past substance abuse issues, as I did. I was an alcoholic, and they helped get me clean and sober, and we started this mission. And then we became family. Family is not always blood. We come together and we love each other, and they gave nothing but unconditional love to me. And I was difficult back then, might still be a little difficult, but they loved me through it. And it wasn't hard getting clean and sober, but with them and with my husband, I did it, and with God. I did have an amazing trip with him. I went to Africa on one of the mission trips. It was amazing. Enjoyed it, and it changed me. I used to be a very materialistic person, but that trip changed me, and I wasn't materialistic anymore. And I focused on what was really important. And he was my Papa John, but I always called him my old timer. And I truly love him, and I love Louise. They are family. And both of them are missed. And I wish we could bring them back at times, but they're in a much better place. They're healthy and happy until we meet again, old timer.
I see.
That was the family from Canada that sang that beautiful song. Wanted to make sure that they were involved in John's memorial here today. We have so many things to be thankful for the way that John lived, but how will he be remembered is the question I believe is on all of our hearts. As we've already heard from dear family and friends, John loved life. He was incredibly strong. He served others remarkably and beautifully. And I'm reminded of this saying, only one life will soon be passed. Only what's done for Christ will last. And I believe John lived his life in a way for the purposes of Jesus Christ, and that will last for eternity. I loved John in so many ways, and the more I got to know him, the more I loved him, and the way that he lived for others was truly remarkable. To know that and hear some of his upbringing growing up on a dairy farm, you learn a strong work ethic very early in life. There is no fudging it when you're a dairy farmer. It's clockwork, and if it's not done by clockwork, it doesn't get done, and it's not a good thing. So that, I'm sure, instilled in John an amazing amount of strong work ethic and helped to develop his character in beautiful ways. As I read through the insert here in our bulletins, I wanted to point out a couple of paragraphs that I think need to be highlighted here as we speak about what John will be remembered for. And on page 2 of that bulletin insert, it's beautifully written. In 1972, John was working for a trucking company and was electrocuted when the box of the cement truck touched the power line carrying 12,000 volts. That's unbelievable that he survived. And it is no coincidence that God had his hand of protection on John for a specific purpose, to not take him home to be with God at that time, because he needed to continue on with the rest of his life in a beautiful way. The nails on the soles of his shoes burned into his feet, his nylon shirt burned into his back, plus many other injuries that he survived. He was unconscious for some time, spent many months in the hospital. It was during this time that he met a nurse named Louise. And in September of 77, he married Louise and adopted her son Matthew, who is here today. John's life is a testament to the power of prayer. His mom and dad, I love this paragraph, his mom and dad passed away praying for his salvation, trusting him to God. And in 1989, John and Louise together committed their lives to Christ, were baptized the following year, and they began living their lives in service to God and never looked back. I love that. In scriptures, we read of stories of transformation over and over again. And in one particular story, there's a man named Saul who was an antagonist toward Christ, hated Christ, put in prison those who loved Christ. And he was going to Damascus one day, and on that road to Damascus, Saul had an encounter with God. And he was struck with blindness. He went to the city that he was going to and had another encounter with someone who explained to him the good news of who Jesus was. John had an encounter with God, and God revealed to him who Jesus was and gave his life to him because of the prayers of his parents for many, many years, that John would fully understand what becoming a follower of Jesus truly meant. And it is so incredibly important for all of us to remember that Damascus Road encounter that John had was placing his faith and his trust in Jesus as his Savior and receiving him as Savior and then giving his life to Jesus, and the rest of John's life began to beautifully point others to faith in Jesus. You don't take 20 missions trips because you don't love God. You take 20 missions trips because you love God, you want to serve Him, and you want to invite others to join you in this amazing journey of following Jesus as Savior. John will be remembered because of that commitment that he had to Jesus Christ. John's favorite passage is found in the Bible in Psalm 102, along with Psalm 23 that was recorded. Psalm 102, verse 18 says this: "Let this be written for a future generation, that a people not yet created may praise the Lord." I love that. For future generations of people that were not yet created, that they would trust Jesus as their Savior and Lord as a result of those who loved God and pointed others to faith in God. Another favorite passage of mine is Psalm chapter 90 that I believe helped puts into the framework of how John lived and what made him tick, what was important to him. And in Psalm 90, it says, "Lord, you have been our dwelling place throughout all generations. Before the mountains were born, or you brought forth the whole world from everlasting to everlasting, you are God. You turn people back to dust, saying, 'Return to dust, you mortals. 1,000 years in your sight are like a day that has just gone by, or like a watch in the night.'" Verse 9, "All our days pass away under your wrath. We finish our years with a moan. Our days may come to 70 years or 80, or in John's case, almost 91 years. And if our strength endures, yet the best of them are filled with but trouble and sorrow. For they quickly pass, and then we fly away. Teach us to number our days, that we may gain a heart of wisdom." I love verse 12, "that we may gain a heart of wisdom." And I believe what drew people to John is the wisdom that he had and the ability that he had to point others to faith in Jesus. And he so beautifully loved his Savior and Lord, and it exuded from who he was. I loved how Chris said he was a man's man, that John knew who Jesus was and wanted others to see who Jesus was as well, which is why he served so beautifully behind the scenes. He did what God called him to do in promoting and pulling people to faith in Jesus Christ. "That we may gain a heart of wisdom." I believe John understood what wisdom was and was found in the person of Jesus. Then verse 17, "May the favor of the Lord our God rest on us. Establish the work of our hands for us." Yes, establish the work of our hands. When life came into complete focus for Papa John and Louise, he had this dream of making sure that others were cared for, and his ability to fix things through the handyman service that John created. I loved seeing the truck of John's service and how he beautifully lived his life for others, and then how he put together this faith house, this second chance house, and how beautifully Sam, he beautifully spoke about what God did in and through to help resurrect lives who were lost, in your beautiful testimony of that today. And that's who John was, to help people come to faith in Jesus by the way that he lived his beautiful life. John will be remembered, will be loved, and will be held in highest regard as we all someday will see him in heaven as well. was a great pastor that many of us loved here at Grace Community Church, Pastor Davidson, who always had a beautiful saying that we all have to have three homes. And those homes included our earthly home, that we go to home at the end of the day and we lay our head on our pillow. We have safety and security in that home, and how important that earthly home is to all of us. And then our second home is our church home, where we go and we connect with followers of Jesus and we engage in life with and we involve in ministry with, and we help hold each other in prayer, and we help serve the needs of our church community, and how important that church home really is. And then Pastor Davidson would say the most important home we have is our heavenly home. And that heavenly home is once we die and we put our lives into this ground and we return to dust, as Psalm 90 just reminded us that we'll all do someday. And that heavenly home is so vitally important because that's where we'll spend eternity. Our minds can't even comprehend what eternity is, because it is an infinite number of years of life that we will live on for infinity with no end in sight. That's eternity. And how vitally important it is for us to have that eternal home secure in our everyday life. And that is simply an act of acknowledgement, saying, Jesus, would you come into my life? And as we do acknowledge that he is Savior, that he is Lord, that we're not, we can't earn our way into heaven, we can't work our way toward salvation. It's a beautiful gift that God gives to us, in that even while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. And if we simply confess with our mouth, believe in our heart who Jesus is, we then can be saved as well. I'm guessing all of us in this room have probably done that, but if you need to be reminded of our heavenly home and the value of that placed on our lives, may Papa John's life remind us how quick life goes. 91 years, a blink. It's amazing how quick life goes by. And let's make sure our heavenly home is secure by trusting in Jesus and placing our faith and our confidence in who Jesus really is. I love the verse in 1 John chapter 5. And this is the testimony. God's given us eternal life. And this life is in his Son, Jesus Christ. He who has the Son, Jesus, has life. He who does not have the Son of God does not have life. I hope and pray all of us in this room will have had an encounter with Jesus. We'll have had a Damascus Road encounter. We'll have an electrocution experience in our life that wakes us up and says, I've got to give my life to Jesus, because life goes by so quickly. We're never assured of tomorrow. We don't know what our life will be like going down the road. We don't know how long God has for us, because all the days ordained for us were written in his book before one of them came to be. We don't know, but let's be prepared. And until that day, let's live for Jesus. Let's live the way that John lived, for others. There's joy in life lived like that, putting Jesus first, others second, and ourselves last, which is how John lived. I hope and pray that he will never be forgotten, that we'll hold him close in our hearts, that we'll live his example out in a sense, and we'll pick up the torch that John is passing on to us, that we'll hold high the banner of Jesus and we'll live for him, because we'll all see him someday soon. I would ask that we just pause in a moment here and just kind of take in what all of our wonderful friends and family have shared here today, what's been said and what's been sung, the beautiful slides that we've just seen, and what words we've just heard, verses we've heard. Take it all in and maybe pray a prayer of commitment as we move forward from this day. And may our lives live in such a way that we'll see Jesus again soon. Would you bow in prayer with me? Let's take a moment just in silence, and then I'll close us in prayer, and we'll sing a beautiful song, a hymn of affirmation, Amazing Grace, that Catherine leads. Let's pause and pray. So good to us. Lord, thank you for this morning here as we've celebrated Papa John. God, thank you for his life, for his ministry, for his impact, for his service, for all of the things that we've just remembered John for. We pause this morning to give you thanks for his life. And Lord, we thank you for the life of Jesus, who was given for all of our sinful condition. Thank you for redeeming us and for calling us into relationship with yourself because of what you provided for us on the cross of Christ. And Lord, I thank you for this morning as we have celebrated John's incredible life. I pray that you would help us to not forget and to hold dear the memories that we have of this amazing saint of Jesus. And so God, we commit him to you. We thank you for him. And we thank you for the impact of John Janzen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. And amen.
Thank you.
Celebrate his life through a beautiful reception together. Join me in prayer as we commit this service to the Lord. Father, we're grateful again for our time together today. God, thank you for all that we have just heard, and as we have honored John today, we give you thanks for his life. We thank you for his memory, and we pray that you would motivate us to live in such a way that honors you as well as others. So Lord, help us to think through how we can appropriate the days that you've given to us to give honor and glory back to you, our precious Savior and Lord, in whose name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
God bless you all. Thank you for your attendance.